heal, deliver, and God sanctifies people.
Yes.
You can have healing. You can have deliverance. And salvation can come to you and your whole household.
Yes.
Why this evening? Because God is in the room.
Yes.
His name is Jesus. Jesus, we give you all the glory, the honor, the credit. Everything due unto your name, all of it goes to you.
Yes.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Praise God. Yahweh. I feel three things to start this service off with. The first thing is I want to talk to you about Psalm 137. This is not my sermon, but God is giving somebody a prophetic word on this night.
Hallelujah.
Psalm 137, verses 1, 2, 3, and 4. By the rivers of Babylon, by the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down. Yea, we wept when we remembered Zion. We hanged our harps upon the willows in the midst thereof. Okay? So there they had left Zion. Zion was the mountain where the temple was. Zion was the mountain where the house of God was. They had left Jerusalem and were carried away captive to Babylon. And there in their captivity they wept by the rivers of Babylon. And they hanged up their musical instruments. They hung their musical instruments upon the trees, the willows, in the midst
thereof.
Yes,
they did.
Yeah,
they did.
I have a problem with that verse. Here's my problem with that verse. Ezekiel 1:1 now. Those same rivers of Babylon, where one group said, I quit. Ezekiel the prophet was also in Babylon. And I read the following in Ezekiel 1:1. It came to pass in the 30th year, in the 4th month, in the 5th day of the month, as I was among the captives, by a river in Babylon, River Chebar, that the heavens were opened, and I saw visions of God.
Amen.
One group at those Babylonian rivers said, I quit, and they hung up all of their gifts in God. And a second man said, I was by the river of Babylon, and there heaven was opened, and I saw God.
Ooh, yeah.
There's a place of decision for somebody in this room tonight. You are at your river of Babylon, one or the other. Either you will quit, or you will see the heavens open, and you will have visions of God. Yours. You can say enough, or you can say, I'm only getting started right here in the kingdom of God.
Somebody
be called up higher. In the will of the Lord, God has more. God has greater, and God has bigger in store for you.
Yes, amen.
Hallelujah.
Whatever that is for, I ask you to receive it in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
That's for you to say, I receive that in Jesus' name.
Hallelujah.
Praise God.
See that. Hallelujah.
For a second person, this prophetic word came to me in the prayer meeting before service even began. God began talking to me about trees. You know, trees get wounded. Trees don't have the same healing system that men do. Trees, when they're wounded, well, actually, I have a friend who studies trees in Dayton, Ohio, named Brother Reinhardt. Brother Reinhardt was telling me that when a tree gets wounded, it will just grow bark, grow wood over the tree. But the wound is still there underneath. And that tree, by the abundance of its growth, it grows beyond the wound. It doesn't exactly take away that wound. It grows beyond it. So for this second person, or it could be the same person, whoever you are, I can choose to focus on that wound I have inside, or I can simply grow past it.
Come on.
And grow beyond it.
Yeah.
What will I do? Will I make the wound the sole focus? Or will I grow beyond it? In the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Come on, brother.
Hallelujah.
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 Lord, you are
incredible.
Yeah.
For a third person here tonight, this story comes to you from Clawson, Michigan. Many years ago, I was at a friend's house in Clawson, Michigan, and my friend pointed to a tree in his backyard and said, you see that tree right there? He said, a few weeks ago, during the winter months, we had a storm, and that branch was no longer there, fell, and knocked out the power line. We were without power for an entire night. He said, there was no storm. Here's what happened. There had been a storm 2 weeks prior, And that storm had broken that part of the tree. That storm had compromised that branch. And that branch was wounded in a storm previously.
Right.
Wounded in a previous storm. And for 2 weeks, that branch held onto that tree. For 2 weeks, that branch seemed like it was fine, like nothing was wrong, but there was a wound in that branch. But then after 2 weeks of holding on, its strength gave out, and it fell, and the power was lost for the entire area.
Wow.
So for a third person, you've been wounded in a previous storm. Not a current battle, but one a long time ago. Years, weeks, months gone by, possibly a decade or two. And you've held on, and to everyone else around you, externally, exteriorly, surface, they think that you're okay. But you're not. You're barely hanging on. And something that is a truth of trees is that when a tree branch has been compromised, an arborist, a tree specialist, can actually go in and uphold that branch and stop it from breaking off.
Amen.
So this service for a third person is the repair of a compromised branch. The repair of someone.
Come on, hallelujah.
You've been wounded in a previous storm, and you've held on, but holding on is not the will of God. I would that ye prosper and be in health.
Yes.
Jesus said, I come that you might have life.
Yes.
And that you might have it more abundantly.
Yes.
It is not the will of God just for you to endure the dark night. God wants you to be strong in the Lord and the power of His might. The joy of the Lord is your strength. And tonight, somebody, it is the will of the Holy Ghost for you to receive your joy. A good second dose of the Holy Ghost. All of us say, Amen. Hallelujah. Praise God.
The tree was me, by the way.
Hallelujah. Praise God.
You wouldn't even believe it.
Wow. In the
I was talking
Jesus.
About trees on the way up here.
Yeah.
Wow.
He was talking to the trees.
Wow.
I was talking.
Apologizing for their wounds.
We just had a horrible 180 mile an hour. I had 180 mile an hour wind, straight line. It was a tornado, straight line, that came through here. It was called a derecho.
Wow.
And it blew a lot of beautiful oak trees. Just uprooted them, destroyed them.
Thousands.
Yes. And we're driving down, and it snapped off 24 poles in a 34-5 Highline down Highway 13 and laid it all on the cornfield. And I'm driving down the road tonight, and I'm seeing trees with bark missing, and they're hurting. And I said,
yeah.
You know, I apologize, Earth, that the sin has caused you so much pain. The sin of man, this earth, the Bible says,
yes.
The whole creation groans and travails together for the appearing of the sons of God. And I am with you. I'm sorry. The wonderful creation of God has suffered such pain due to the sin of man. And I was apologizing to the trees on the way up here.
Yes, I said,
I'm sorry.
The mind of God.
I'm sorry.
For their wounds.
Hallelujah. I said, I'm sorry.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
I apologize to trees. I really did. Brother, you can't imagine how on the nail head you were.
In Jesus' name, God, you receive the glory, the credit, the honor, and the praise for everything you're receiving. In the name of the Lord Jesus, the Lord is good.
Yes.
The goodness of the Spirit is here in this room. Let's take 30 seconds and just get right in this room. Luke 16. Now, one final word. This will not be the sermon. Someone's in a battle that God is asking you to release. A battle that God is asking you to release. Not to fight, but to release. Wherever that is the one sentence prophetic word. Release the battle. Don't even fight it. Read what God and Moses said back and forth in the book of Exodus. The battle is not ours, but yours. The battle is not yours, Israel. It is the Lord's. Luke 16 and verse 19. This is the message. Luke 16, verse 19. When you're there, say, I'm there.
I'm there.
I'm there.
Okay. These are the words of Jesus. There was a certain rich man, which was clothed in purple and fine linen, fared sumptuously every day. He was doing okay. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at his gate full of sores, and desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. He wasn't so much doing okay. Verse 22, and it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. And in hell, say hell.
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 And in hell, he lift up his eyes, being in torments. Sober thought. Going to preach to you on the last prayer from hell. The last prayer from hell. Lord, all glory, honor, and praise goes to you. Speak to us.
Yes, Lord.
Receive
yes, Lord.
Your word with gladness of hearts.
Hallelujah.
Open the door of the Spirit. Open the door of salvation.
Yes.
Just open the door for us, Lord God, tonight. In the name of Jesus, we give you, Lord God, the credit, the honor, the glory, the praise for everything we're doing here in this house. We all say, yes. In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Jesus name. Amen. This is not a parable.
Oh,
Jesus says, there was a certain rich man.
Right.
Specific.
Okay.
And when Jesus says, there was a certain rich man,
yeah.
There was a certain rich man
yeah, right.
Who really, truly
right.
lived
right.
and
right.
really, truly died. Right. He was clothed in purple. And fine linen. Purple was the color of royalty. He had an official position, a political status. He had some kind of title. He had a name. People knew who he was. He was somebody in that city.
Yeah.
But even though he was somebody in the world, even though he had the color purple, the royal robes and vestures, with position and money. Even though he had fine linen, expensive clothing, he didn't shop at Walmart, bless God, okay? He fared sumptuously. He was eating on the high end of the hog, we'd say in Tennessee.
Yeah.
He was faring sumptuously. He had good food. He had good ribeye steaks, bless God. Even though he had all that, he was lacking in the most important area. He did not have his name written above.
That's right. Come
dear
on.
Dear brothers and dear sisters, mark this down. No matter how good the meat that you eat is, no matter how fine the clothing that you wear is, no matter how well known your name might be, if your name is not known by the only one who should know your name,
yeah.
You have missed out, dear one. You are lacking in that most vital, crucial, and significant area of life. Whoever I am and whoever I think I am, or whoever I might be, I must be saved.
Right.
Yes,
amen.
Amen.
There was also a second man in this story. There was a certain beggar named Lazarus. Notice that he is named,
right.
And the rich man is not.
Yeah. Specific,
God knew Lazarus' name, but did not know the rich man's name. Depart from me, I never knew you. God didn't know that rich man's name, but he knew the beggar's name. And no matter what he was lacking here in this life, he had that most precious pearl of great price.
Yes,
he had that which is worth more than all the gold out here, than all the wealth and the health and the status of this world. He had his name recorded in heaven.
Right.
Whatever I might miss out on in this life, whatever Bank of America or Regions Bank might say about me. God records my name in His
holy book.
God remembers who you are. God numbers every hair upon the heads of the saved and sanctified souls here tonight. Does God know your name, my dear friends?
Hallelujah.
Lazarus, he was laid at the gate full of sores. He was not allowed inside the gate of the rich man. The rich man put him out of his own property, but all that whole conversation is about to flip and reverse here in a few verses.
Come on.
In the Word of God.
Oh, yeah, buddy.
He was desiring, verse 21, desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Which means if he was desiring to have them, that means he did not have them, okay?
Right.
He didn't have them. He desired those crumbs, but did not have those crumbs. He didn't even have the smallest specks of the feeding of the rich man. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. So according to everything outwardly seen, he was at the animal level, the level of the dogs.
Oh.
And yet according to God, he was up there with the angels.
Yeah.
Do not base the opinion of yourself here in this world on what other people see.
That's right.
Base it solely
Amen.
Upon right. the eyes of God.
That's right.
See with eyes of faith. I don't walk by sight. I walk by faith. I am not basing my decisions upon the peer pressures of our secular culture and the whims of politics. No! My direction from life comes from that heavenly North Star that I call the Holy Ghost. All right?
Amen.
You are in God. Who you are, you are declared to be by the Creator who formed and framed the worlds. That is who you really are.
Amen.
Are you a son and a daughter of Jesus?
Thank you, Lord.
Then came that day, the great day of the evening out. There is a great day where everything, the crooked is made straight. The doors closed, shut and sealed for all time. The scales are tipped. There is an evening out that will come. It came to pass that beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. There is truly a place of peace and rest.
Yes.
Call it Abraham's bosom. Call it paradise. Jesus told the thief on the cross, "Today you will be with me in paradise." Call it heaven, but whatever term you personally prefer, there is a place that Jesus has made for the righteous dead. Those who are dead in Christ shall rise first one day.
Amen.
You're going to have a resurrection to come on that great morning at the last trump with the voice of the archangel. The dead in Christ shall rise first. And we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together to meet them in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord.
Yes. Hallelujah.
That is true.
Yes, it is.
Tree of life is in the paradise of God. Revelation chapter 2 tells you.
Yes.
And a different chapter in that same book says the leaves of that tree are for the healing of nations. We are among those nations here this evening, and we need healing. And I must share with you, there might be some healings. I want you to have every healing that you can in the Apostolic Church.
Yes.
But even if I miss out on all the healing available,
you,
there will be a day where the leaves of that tree are given to me for the healing of my mind, and the healing of my heart, and the healing of my soul. There will be a day where all the tears are wiped away from my eyes and from my face, and every single lacking, every single pressure point of this world will just drop away as distant memories, and I will have joy and rest and peace.
Praise God.
But if I choose not to go with God on that eternal morning, if I choose not the way of life, there is only one alternative option. And that rich man saw it. That rich man also died and was buried. And in hell, he lifted up his eyes, being in torments. And in verse number 23, let us all pick up the story of the narrative of that rich man. He lifted up his eyes, being in torments. There is a place called hell. A place where there is no peace. There is no peace, saith God, to the wicked. The prophet Isaiah recorded in his word many long centuries ago, a place where peace is no longer available. A place where rest is impossible. A place where their worm dieth not. Their worm, T-H-E-I-R, personal possessive pronoun in English grammar, meaning their personal tuned torment. There is a sense in hell in which the torments are personal to the individual.
That's right.
Worm, I believe that.
Dies not.
Absolutely.
He sees Abraham afar off. You are not annihilated in hell. Annihilation is false doctrine. Soul sleep is false doctrine. He was not asleep. He was not annihilated. He was there alive and awake. He could see. It was him. It was the rich man, the word of God records. And he sees Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. One of the torments in hell, I am personally convinced, is they can see everything that they missed and cannot have anymore. Now that rich man is on the outside looking in. Lazarus was not allowed in the gates of the rich man in that life, but now he is not allowed in Lazarus' domain in the next life. He cries and says, Father Abraham, don't stop there.
Right.
Look at that word, Father. Say Father.
Father.
Father Abraham, that is a Jewish Hebrew Old Testament term. That means he was a descendant of Abraham. He was a Jew.
He was a Jew.
He was a Hebrew. He was a one God believer. Crazy truth. There are one God believers in hell. He had heard Deuteronomy 6 and 4 all of his life. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. He knew the one God message. But knowing is not enough. The demons know and tremble. It is not enough to know. You must live it. Be ye doers of the word and not hearers only. I feel to speak out loud the words of Jesus in Matthew chapter 7. Keep your finger on this 16th chapter of Luke and turn to the 7th chapter of Matthew, verse number 21. Not every one that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven. So who does? But he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. Not enough to know. You must do the will of the Father. I must be a doer of the word, not a hearer only. I must do the will of God to enter the kingdom of God. I must do what God has called me and tasked me and asked me to do.
Yes, amen. Hallelujah. Yes, thank you.
That is the meaning of that principle.
Hallelujah.
He cries and says, Father Abraham.
Yeah.
I can't gloss over this. I gotta keep talking to you here for a moment. God is convicting me in my heart, in my soul, and in my mind. My father told me over and over again on many occasions, Joel, do you know who will scream the loudest in hell? Who, Dad? The ones who know what they missed. The ones who have been in an apostolic church. The ones who heard the one God message. He had heard the one God message. He had been in the temple. I believe that man had set foot in the city of God. I believe that man had been to Jerusalem. He had been in the house of God. He heard the one God sermons and just chose not to live them. He chose something else. There are people in hell, I truly believe, who have been in revival services in Apostolic Acts 2:38, Jesus' name, Holy Ghost, holiness churches, but did not come to the altar and did not give their lives, their hearts, their futures, and their alls to Jesus.
Come on now.
Something else was more important. I call that idolatry. Something else took place. Something else took precedence. They didn't come to the altar. They didn't come to the baptistry. They didn't come to God. And instead, they come to hell. Father Abraham, have mercy on me.
Oh, Jesus.
And send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. The first prayer in hell is a prayer for mercy. Have mercy on me. But mercy is no longer possible. And God is a God of mercy. Catch the craziness going on here. His mercies are made new every morning. That's the word of God.
Yeah.
For his mercy endureth forever. Over and over and over and over and over again in the Psalms and the Old Testament Proverbs. God is, always has been, always will be a God of mercy. Mercy is who he is, and mercy is what he does. But if I cross that eternal bar and go beyond the boundary line and marker of this life, mercy becomes a place that I cannot go to anymore. Mercy is now beyond the reach of the arm of man.
Lord Jesus. Oh God.
Send Lazarus. He still thinks of Lazarus like some servant boy here.
Yeah.
Right. He still
yeah.
thinks of Lazarus
yeah.
as some man, some
right.
gopher
yeah.
in an office.
Jesus.
He can send over here,
uh-huh.
over there.
Uh-huh.
That's not how it works anymore.
No.
And
yeah.
it's no longer
yeah.
the setup and the situation and circumstance in this setting, dear rich man. That he may dip the tip of his finger in water, cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame in a way that I will not be able to explain to you scientifically, biologically, and anatomically. People feel pain in hell. He was tormented. He felt pain.
Yes, he did.
Abraham explains it to
us.
Abraham said, verse 25, Son, say son.
Son.
Making it crystal clear that he was a descendant, a son of Abraham.
Right.
Son, remember that you in your lifetime received your good things, and likewise Lazarus, evil things. But now he is comforted and you are tormented.
Yes.
In my opinion, that is a direct, almost a direct word-for-word application of the sermon of Jesus. The last shall be first, and the first shall be last. Now all of that is flipped,
yeah.
isn't it?
Yeah.
Yep.
And beside all this, verse 26, between us and you there is a great gulf
yeah.
fixed. And that word fixed means it's there in place and cannot be moved. It is not some movable, interchangeable boundary line like some office wall. It's fixed. It's set. It can't be shortened. So they which would pass from here in paradise to you in hell cannot. Mm-hmm. Neither can they pass to us in paradise that would come from thence in hell. Making it very plain that hell is permanent. Hell is a one-way trip.
That's
a
right.
one
Woo!
In a lifetime.
That's
a
ticket. Truth.
You go forever.
Yep.
That's
no
right.
exits.
Then he said, no exits, that's right. Then he said, I pray thee therefore, Father, that you would send him, Lazarus, to my father's house. For I have five brothers, that he may testify unto them, lest they also come into this place of torment. And here I get my title, Last Prayer from Hell. The last prayer from hell, I call the message thus, because the last prayer from hell of this rich man is that none of his family
yes.
would ever be lost.
Wow.
Yes.
None of them
that
would
was.
Ever be condemned
yeah.
to
right.
burn for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
And even so, that it was that rich man's prayer from hell, so it is my prayer tonight that nobody I love,
Amen.
Nobody I have met,
right.
nobody that I care about would ever burn forever in the
right.
fires of torment. I don't want anybody to go to hell.
Amen.
I want you to go to heaven. I want you to spend
yes.
the great forever
yes.
beyond
yes.
with God.
That's
I want
right.
you to have love
yes.
and peace and joy and strength and forevermore pleasures for all time eternally with the Lord. But I can't make you go there.
No.
I can't make anybody go to heaven. I can't make anybody go to hell. That is our choice.
Amen.
In fact, I believe that great gulf between hell and heaven is already being fixed in my life right now. Everything. I'll settle this right now. All of it is a heaven or hell issue.
Come on.
Everything I do,
Amen.
I am drawing closer to God
yeah.
or closer to the pit.
Yeah.
I am getting closer to heaven
yeah.
or closer to
yes.
hell.
Yes.
What do I choose?
Yes.
Where will I go?
Woo.
May it break Salvation Day.
Yeah. choice at a time.
But is it really that? It is. I am making myself more like Jesus, or I am making myself more like this world.
Come on now.
Matthew 25 and verse 41. These are also the words of Jesus. Notice now, everything that I am reading to you are the words of Jesus. Do not mischaracterize and caricature the words of our great Master and Lord. He preached on hell. He preached salvation and damnation. He preached you were either going to go and be forever with Him, or you would be lost. Don't make Jesus into a guru of some kind. Jesus offered eternity and tried to pull you out of the fire. That is who He was. He was the Savior. His goal was salvation. Then, Matthew 25, verse 41, then shall He say also unto them on the left hand, depart from me, ye cursed. He didn't curse them. We curse or bless ourselves.
That's right.
Depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire. How long is that fire?
Yeah.
Everlasting. Hell is not temporal or temporary. Hell is
everlasting.
Everlasting. It is forever. Eternal. Yes. Prepared for the devil and his angels. God didn't make hell for us.
That's right.
It was never the perfect will of God for one human being to go to hell.
Yeah.
Hell was made for the devil and fallen angels, never for man. God never sent or desired to send man to hell.
Yeah.
It is man who goes there.
Yes.
And now Revelation chapter 20 and verse 11.
Yes.
I am reading to you the best I can
what
the Word of God says on this subject. The book of endings and the book of beginnings. And I saw a great white throne, 20th chapter, verse 11, Revelations. I saw a great white throne, and Him that sat on it, Him, singular, one on that throne.
That's right.
One God, Him that sat on it. From whose face the earth and the heaven fled away. You can run, but you can't hide on that great day. And there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. We shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. So Christ and God are the same person. There
are
two and there are three. There's one. I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened. Say books.
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 Books, plural. And another book, the second book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books, plural, according to their works. What are those books, plural? It is not talking about the book of life. That is referenced separately. What are those books, plural, being referred to and discussed here? As we read, it is said, though the dead were judged out of those things written in the books. They are books of record where are recorded all the deeds of your life.
Yep.
And that convicts me. That concerns me, Pastor, because I know I have seasons of life that I am not proud of.
Yep.
And there will be a day when everything I have ever done, every deed I am guilty of, every sin I have committed, is read and spoken aloud for all time before God and all His holy angels. Every word of profanity and verb of cursing, every image of pornography I have stared at, every act of violence I have committed ever in my life, every bad, sinful, poisonous season, all of it spoken out loud, and everybody will hear it. Well, I don't want that to happen. Well, the good news is there is a way to dodge that.
Right.
You can have your sins remitted.
Yes.
Washed in the blood.
Yes.
Will your robe be white and spotless? on that great day, my friends, there is one way I can repent of my sins and be baptized in the name of Jesus. If I am guilty of any sin in my life tonight, this is an old-fashioned repentance service.
Yeah.
And every soul will be out those doors of completion. I am calling on everybody here in the sound of my voice to repent of all of your sins and find a place of prayer and lay everything, all of it, every single solitary bit and deed at the feet of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Turn away. If you do, if you repent, if you seek the face of God, He can wash all of it and remove it and blot it out of that divine and great ledger in the books of record. But if you don't, the sea gave up the dead in it. Death and hell delivered up the dead in them. And they were judged, every man according to their works. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And the punch verse. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. There is no carpool lane. There is no alternative road. There's only one way. There's only one door. Jesus said, I am the door. He is the way.
That's right.
The truth. And the life. 21st chapter Revelations and verse number 8. I'm going to wrap this up here. Who goes to hell? The fearful and the unbelieving. The abominable. The murderers and whoremongers, sorcerers, idolaters, idol worshippers, and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. I know that I have done a whole bunch of that. First group cast in the lake of fire are the fearful. I'm afraid to come to church. I'm afraid to pay my tithes. I'm afraid to come to the altar. I'm afraid of what my girlfriend will think of me when she sees me worshiping and slobbering and snorting and snotting and speaking in tongues. I'm afraid of what my friends will say about me at school or at my job. I'm afraid of what my spouse will say when I get home. Fear is the number one reason why people miss out on eternity. Fear is the number one obstacle between us and the Lord. Unbelief, secretly, privately, quietly, unspeakably, hidden unbelief, the doubt, the absence. All you need is a grain of mustard seed faith. The tiniest seed of faith is enough. Just have the seed, and that's all it takes. Please receive the seed of God. The abominable. I looked up the word abominations. I looked up the word abominations several weeks ago in Hebrew. And the word abominations, this changed my life. The word abomination means disgusting. Something disgust. An abomination is something that disgusts God. Divine disgust. I do things that are disgusting to the Lord. I am grossing out my God by certain things in my life. Certain things make God go, ooh, I wish you wouldn't do that.
That's right.
Get that, whatever the that is for you, get it out. Get it away out of your system, out of your life. Don't let it cost you forever.
Yes, Jesus.
Buy the truth and sell it not.
Yes, Jesus.
But if I buy the truth, then truth has a cost, doesn't it?
Yes, sir.
Pay the cost.
Pay the cost.
The fearful, the unbelieving, abominable, murderers. I've never killed anybody with my hands, but with my lips, with my tongue, and my words, with my fingers on the keyboards of social media, internet comment sections online, I have murdered people and assassinated brothers and sisters with my sentences, paragraphs, and my lips.
The Thank you, Jesus.
Whoremongers, sexual sins. Whoever looks on a woman with lust has committed adultery with her in his heart. Those are the words of Jesus. Sorcerers, and the word sorcery is associated in the Old Testament with witchcraft. In Greek, pharmakeia, the root word for drug use. Drug use sends you to the lake of fire. Those witches who made potions, those potions weren't magical. They were drugs.
That's right.
Drug use was there. Witches were drug dealers of the ancient world, okay? And all who participate in the lifestyle of drugs are going to miss out on the great forever. Idol worship, whatsoever comes between me and God, is an idol. Anything between me and God is an idol in my heart and in my life. And finally, all liars, even teeny, weeny, itsy, bitsy, teeny, tiny lies. Anything I say that is not true puts me in the place with Adolf Hitler. All the great people of old who were sinners, awful individuals, those swallowed up by life, murderers, adulterers, whoremongers, and everybody who ever spoke an untruth, they have their part in the lake of fire.
Yes.
So how do I avoid it? How do I dodge this bullet of forever? Acts 2:38. I want you all to read this out loud with me. Let there be no question mark of what it takes. Acts chapter 2, verse 38 and 39. I want you all to see this. Actually, begin at verse 37. When they heard this, they were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? So what the apostles of Peter tell them? Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized. How many of you? Every one of you. How? In the name of Jesus Christ. Why? For the remission of sins. And we're not done. One more step. And ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. How do you know you got it? The same thing that will happen to you, you will happen to them on the day of Pentecost. You will speak with new tongues as the Spirit gives you the utterance. Verse 39. For the promise, this promise, is unto you and to your children, and to all that are afar off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. We are afar off. We are several thousand miles away from Mount Zion in the city of Jerusalem, Israel. We are 2,000 years and several thousand miles afar off from where they were on that day. And this promise is for us and for you.
Hallelujah.
For a few minutes, I ask you all this. Find a place to pray. On this Saturday evening of revival, I want an old-fashioned repentance service. Every one of us. Find a place to pray.
Jesus.
Sitting, kneeling, standing, walking around, whatever you're more comfortable with. All of us, find a place to talk with the Lord.